I was going to continue kind of on that duffing system. If you remember from last time, duffing system, that was that perturbed oscillator that's in a double well potential that has an unstable central point and then two wells. So it's double welled but shaken. One version was a ball on a track where you take the frame where the track is and you just sort of shake it back and forth with some time periodic manner. And there's a ball. And it's moving along, and we could measure X from the central point. It's an unstable equilibrium, and then there's two stable equilibrium on either side. So the duffing system is like a prototype of this type of situation. If it was a frame that's not moving, it wouldn't be too terribly exciting because the frame, things would just dampen out and it would go away. So it looks like X double dot equals X minus X cubed minus delta X dot plus some forcing cosine omega T. So we looked last time at delta of 0.25. That's the damping. And omega equals one, non-dimensionalized. Omega is just one. If F equals 0.4, then we had that strange attractor. And things would wander on that forever, right? And that's because, how did we get a strange attractor? If this is just second order, then we would have, x dot equals y, y dot equals stuff. It looks like it's just a two-dimensional ODE, but of course, time is in here. And we've mostly been talking before about ODEs that do not depend on time, meaning autonomous. But in this case, this would be non-autonomous. So this y dot term would depend on, it'd be a function of like x, y, and t. So because of the t, it's like we have a third dimension. Some people call it the extended phase space. So there's like x, y, and then time. And in that space, if you start with initial conditions, they might go places, but they won't intersect each other. So maybe they'll just go around. So we have enough dimensions here. We have three dimensions for our ODE. So that's enough for chaos. And it lends itself to laboratory experiments. Last time we said at F equals 0.4, there was this strange attractor that's seen, at least in the numerical system. If you adjust that a little bit, so you can get other types of behavior. If we turn that knob and go to F of 0.25, we get two limit cycle attractors. I don't know what the full bifurcation diagram is. Like there's three parameters here, omega, delta, and F. If we're just keeping delta and omega the same and just turning F down, then we go away from the strange attractor to two limit cycles. And the limit cycles will be related to these stable equilibria and probably just kind of moving around the stable equilibria. But you get sensitive dependence on initial conditions, but now it's sensitive dependence on where you ultimately end up. What do I mean? Let me show. This is a time series of x as a function of time. It's starting out at x naught and then y naught, which is just the initial velocity. This is at 0.201. And you'll notice there's this region here before it settles down to the right well. The right well, right, positive x. So this settles down to right well limit cycle after transient chaos. So we've spoken of these two varieties of chaos, the sort of self-sustaining chaos that doesn't seem to end. That's what a strange attractor gives. But you could also have transient chaos. You could kind of have an arbitrary amount of time where something is going through this transient chaos and then settles down. If you just nudge this initial condition slightly, so just change x naught to 0.195. So what we've changed a very small percentage, the picture will look different. So you still have transient chaos, but you notice what's going on. This is settling down into the left well. In fact, they seem to almost be tracking each other. If you look at the two time series, it looks like they match. Up until about, I would say, this point. And then where this goes down and up, this one goes down and stays down. And then it settles in to that left well. So suppose we took this XY plane and just color-coded initial conditions. We could figure out what are the regions that end up in, say, one well versus another well. that would be related to finding the basin boundaries. So there's some basin, there's some region that leads to the right well, settling down in the right well, and there's some basin that leads to settling down in the left well. This is just color coding X and Y, which is X dot. So from left to right, it's these rainbow colors, blue to red. After one iterate, meaning one period, this is where those initial conditions go. So you see this yellow band would be things that are ending up on the right, blue is on the left, just after one period of the forcing. So we're still doing forcing. This is after two periods, and you see this, what looks like stretching and folding. This is, I think, three periods, four periods. And it's the same sort of thing that we've seen, stretching, folding, reinjection. And it will end up looking very complicated. So it'll look like this. And the boundary between things that are going to the left side well and the right side well is a fractal. You could even try to calculate the fractal dimension is. That boundary is going to have a dimension, something larger than one, but less than two. So we're just talking about the boundary line between the red and blue here. All right. So these are fractal basin boundaries. So this is another place fractals show up. I think when I first talked about fractals, it was fractal basin boundary of flipping over for the double pendulum, and it had some kind of form like this, but we wrapped it around on the torus, representing the two angles for the pendulum. But this is simpler, it's just X and Y. We get fractal basin boundaries. And that's because we have more than one attractor in this case. For when we turned up the forcing magnitude up to 0.4, everything is going to the strange attractor. So there's no basin boundary there. Everything is the basin of attraction for that attractor. Here, there's two coexisting attractors. When we spoke of the Lorentz system, there was some range of that R parameter using the other two values as the traditional values. There was some range of the parameters where there were two coexisting attractors. There was a strange attractor and then I think fixed points. So someone has probably calculated the fractal basin boundary between those two. So this is simpler than the Lorentz system, because the Lorentz system was autonomous, but the entire 3D space came into play. Here, time is special. We could think of time as a phase-based direction, but I mean, what are we doing? We're looking at kind of strobing the system, you know, flashing a light every one period, because everything repeats itself after one period. If you think of it in terms of a vector field, we've got a vector field that is periodically changing. And so all we need to know is what phase in that cycle we are. So time isn't just the real line. We could actually think of time as being cyclical. And if we do that, we get some significant simplification in how we analyze this. So we're going to now back up and try to look at the origin of chaos in this type of system and connect it to something called the Smale horseshoe, ways of understanding chaos at the level of symbolic dynamics. Pretty ambitious. See where we go.